What's up, geeks, and welcome to the channel. In the previous video of the series, we redesigned our initial Spring Boot project to follow more of a clean architecture mentality, and the main idea we focused on was the isolation of the business logic and the domain from other parts of our application. The business logic doesn't and shouldn't care about our API details, for example. To do that, we followed a layered architecture approach, allowing us to isolate the domain, which is the central part of our app. As a quick recap, we started by decoupling our main JPA entity, the video entity, from the rest of the application and placed it in an infrastructure package dedicated to storing everything that has to do with external communications and storage. Additionally, the domain entity reflecting that JPA entity was placed in its specific application or core layer of our design where our main services will sit. The main service of our small app was injected into the controller located in our API layer. The controller's only responsibility is making use of the logic exposed to it via that service. The simple design we put together allowed us to decouple the client from the business from the database. But why did we do that? How can we further improve it? And what are the small catches we left out in our previous video? You see, one of the main advantages of decoupling our layers is the ability to expand each one separately. What do we mean by that? Suppose we now have multiple storage options, like an external database, an in-memory database, and a filing system all at the same time. In our initial implementation, to switch between the different repos, we will have to modify every part of our application, from the service all the way down to the infrastructure implementation details, because the repository being injected into the service is currently JPA specific. However, now all we must do is abstract the functionalities we need into an interface. This interface will be the exposed repository from our infra layer to our application layer and will contain all the functionalities we need, regardless of the underlying storage option. All the storage options we have will implement this interface, allowing us to easily interchange them at runtime or compile time. So, as you can see in our example, we created an in-memory repository and a JPA repository, both of which extend the iRepository interface. This interface will be used in the service, and we can decide at that level which implementation we want to inject by changing a single word with the help of the @qualifier annotation. If you are using Lombok to inject your repository at the level of the service with @qualifier, you might need to add the qualifier annotation to the list of copyable annotations in the Lombok config file. Or if you've watched our previous videos about Spring Boot configuration, you can also go all the way and move this whole logic to be at configuration level. By doing this, we are decoupling the storage options from the whole code. This also allows us to select different implementations based on the profiles we are trying to run, whether dev or prod, for example. Okay, in our previous video, we mentioned the importance of DDD and how creating a model for our app using a ubiquitous language will ease the coding process, leading to an overall model-driven design of the code. So, how can we make use of this here? You see, in the simple example, we can argue that the video class is the modeling of our domain, as every action we are doing revolves around videos. This places this model at the center of our application diagram and pushes us to only depend on this model. However, we can also argue that in our current implementation, the domain does know about the infrastructure right there in the mapper. The video entity class is being accessed by the service. So, should we move the mapper to the infra part or keep it here? Moving it to the infra part will ensure that the domain is completely isolated, but it will mess with the inward dependency we previously discussed, as by moving it we allow the infrastructure into the core module. So, which is the better option? This is a big debate, so I will answer this question from my own perspective. In my opinion, if you are dealing with one storage option and only one, then both approaches are fine, and that is why we left it as is in the previous video. However, if you are dealing with multiple storage options, similarly to the new design we just introduced, then it is better to move it to the infra and isolate the domain completely. Why? Well, because multiple storage options may introduce multiple entity types. For example, the video entity we have here may be suitable for Postgres and in-memory, but may not be suitable for a file storage option, and handling all these conversions in our core module does not align with the clean design and architecture principles we've been discussing. So, the next thing we are going to do is move all the mapping logic alongside its package to the infra part of our application. However, note that by doing this, you will have to create a wrapper for the JPA repository provided by Spring and will not be able to make use of it directly like we previously did. That is actually one cause as why people still prefer to do the mapping in the service. Additionally, some people also prefer to aggregate mappers with JPA and API entities into single classes, meaning we will have, let's say, that JPA video entity class, and inside this class we will provide a way to transition to the domain entity. This will allow us to leave the main domain entity intact, as all other entities of our application now depend on it. If this domain does not change, we are free to play around with other entities as much as we like. However, if this main model changes, other entities might be impacted. Small note here, some people prefer to move the mapper naming convention along with the functionalities, some don't. Feel free to do whatever you are comfortable with. Okay, now, this idea can be taken a step further and applied on the API layer of our app. API requests and responses can encapsulate their own logic. Some may even go ahead and create additional classes at domain level to represent these requests instead of mapping the API requests to the main model directly. This allows more flexibility on the model, meaning if the model changes, our functionalities will remain intact. It will be easier to get rid of the mappers as they become less complex and cumbersome, mapping to the domain will be cleaner and more readable. I know I have mentioned this before, but please keep in mind that code design is a very broad subject and you may have completely different ideas in mind than what we are covering. Just know that nothing we say is set in stone. Everything we mention is purely a mix of our own personal perspective backed by the Clean Architecture book. Okay, with that out of the way, the last thing I want to mention and try to kick off today is testing. One fundamental rule of clean architecture is testability. No matter how much we think our code and design are clean, if it is hard to test the different layers, parts, or units of your app, then it isn't. You see, the basic idea is to be able to test our application as a whole and at the same time be able to test the smallest units that make it. Sure, unit testing, we can go ahead and mock its dependencies on other layers. But if we must mock every aspect of our application every time, then that's bad news, as this means that our application is very much interdependent. Design should minimize mocking, all while allowing us to test whatever, however we want. Stay tuned for the next part of the series in which we further expand on this topic, dive deeper into design for testability with TDD, and cover many functionalities offered by Spring Boot. So that's it for this video. I hope it was helpful. Thank you guys for watching. Take care, and I will see you in the next one.